the substitution step, right? Plug things in for x. This time it's going to be negative 1. Same thing's going to happen to negative 1 as happened to negative 2. First, it's going to get cubed. It's going to also be multiplied by negative 3. And, well, this is just negative 1, right? So some of you wound up with negative 3 because you're trying to go too fast. You're not, you know, you weren't listening when I said write down all your work. Write down all your work. Okay? Do I write down all my work?
Yeah.
No, because no. You, like, went to college, so you just have to, like, instilled into your brain.
You're
the smartest human in math.
No, wait a minute. That's not fair. I'm not a human calculator. When I'm at a restaurant and someone says, oh, I spent $2.56 and I also had this thing. I had one of these drinks, but you know, the total came to $6.42, so how much is each one of those, and what's my tip? I don't know. I'm not a human calculator. I don't just add things up and then find percentages in my brain. But I have practiced especially algebraic things so many times that no, I don't write down all my work. In fact, if I were going to plug negative 1 into this thing, I'd probably do it all in my head and get my Y answer and be wrong maybe 1% of the time. Okay. Very low likelihood that I'm going to get that wrong. But when I first started, when I wanted to get it right, I definitely showed all my work. I did not skip corners, and cut corners, and skip steps. And, okay. So to write down all my work would mean what? What's this next step? What's that?
You have to solve it. You
have to
start.
Yeah, I got to start like doing all the arithmetic here, right? So how would I? You know, somebody who got negative 3 here didn't show all their work. What work could they show that would stop them maybe from getting a negative 3?
You could write negative 1 3 times.
Yeah. Now, just interpret what this is saying quite literally and just write it down. And then maybe, well, this isn't really a big interpretation needed here. I could multiply these together. What's negative 3 times negative 1?
3.
So we're adding 3. Okay. And what's negative 1 times negative 1?
1.
1. Positive 1.
Remember, we're multiplying them, so negative 1 times negative 1 is
positive
1. Now we have a positive 1 times a negative 1.
Makes it
a negative 1. Plus 3 plus 1. Okay. Now, you might, okay, as a kind of a beginning algebra student, just to easing into these algebra ideas, you might take negative 1 and add 3, and then get 2, and then add 1, and then get 3, okay? But it might be a little faster if you notice that you have a negative 1 here and a positive 1 there. What's negative 1 plus 1?
0.
1.
Negative 1 plus 1 is 0, and all that's left is
3.
3, okay. You can look for those cancellations that happen if you got negatives and positives in the same number. Whatever, we both get 3. Whether you take negative 1 plus 3 and plus 1, or you cancel out the negative and positive 1, you still get 3. Okay? Now, what's going to happen when you plug in 0 and onto all those x's?
It's going to be 1.
0.
We're going to get 0 anywhere that there's an x being multiplied, right? X being multiplied here, 0 times 0 times 0. Negative 3 times 0. This is all 0.
There's 1 left.
0 plus 1.
It's getting a lot easier for me.
Good. That's good.
Yeah.
All right. Now, let's switch this out. I don't recommend that you actually, in your notes, erase those things. I really think you should write them repeatedly, okay? Especially if you can catch mistakes. That's the most important thing, is to be able to catch your mistakes. If you erase a mistake and you have a mistaken answer, you have to start all over. If you have all the work written down, you can find the mistake and fix it much faster. So we plug in a 1 there, and now we're going to have a 1 times 1 times 1 is
1.
Positive 1, not negative 1. Negative 3 times 1.
Negative
3. And then we have a plus 1.
I got confused at that part because I thought you had that minus 1 from 3.
Minus 1 from 3.
Yeah, so you can get negative 2. Plus 1 is negative 1.
Which part laying up here or here? Here.
Down at the bottom.
This one.
Yeah.
You thought you had to subtract 1 from 3.
Yeah.
Well, you don't subtract 1 from 3, you subtract 3 from 1.
Yes.
Right? So what about this makes you think subtract 1 from 3?
because of the negative, because I thought the negative was a minus sign when I did it.
Well, if it's written just like this, it is a minus sign, but it's a minus sign for the 3, so we're going to subtract 3.
Yes.
Whatever, right? Not, we're not going to subtract 1, we're going to subtract 3.
Yes, that's fine.
Okay. So you subtract 3 from 1, that's correct.
Okay.
Where 1 minus 3 is negative 2.
Okay.
Okay, negative 2 plus 1.
3.
Negative
3.
Okay, let's look at 1 minus 3. Okay, here's the 1 minus 3 part. Here's 1, right, on the number line. Here's 0. We're at 1. We're going to subtract 3. That means we're going to go back 3. 1, 2, 3. That puts us where?
Negative
2, right? 1 minus 3, negative 2. Then we're going to add 1. So we go to the right, and we're at negative 1. Okay. It's a pretty common thing to think, okay, negative 3 plus 1, so or negative 2 plus 1. So here's 0, I'm at negative 2. I see this all the time. You add 1, and you wind up at negative 3. Okay? Because maybe you think, oh, it's negative, so if I'm going to add it to the negatives, I'm going to go this way. But adding is always to the right. Subtracting is always to the left. Unless we're adding negative numbers and subtracting negative numbers. Right? But your typical adding and subtracting of regular old numbers, adding is to the right. Subtracting to the left. Okay. So if we have negative 2 and we add 1, we move to the right 1, we're at negative 1. So all that is to say this is a negative 1. Yeah, I'm erasing this because I don't have all the room in the world, but you have paper for days. Okay, so you can just write your work for the next one somewhere new. Plug a 2 in, 2 cubed, 2 times 2.
Times 2. 4.
Times 2, yeah. Maybe you're starting to feel a little better with that. Maybe today you just got to the point where you can reliably not write this work down and get the right answer. Minus 3 times 2, negative 3 times positive 2 is negative 6. 2 times 2 times 2 is 8. Minus 6 plus 1. 8 minus 6 is 2, plus 1 is 3.
Yay!
Now, some of you have, taken the extra step here, and graphed.
No, unless you ask us to graph it, we have to.
No, I wouldn't have expected you. I'm disappointed that you didn't graph it, but if you did, go ahead and graph it.
I graph one. Boom, 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 boom.
Okay, so we should talk about that. Avery.
In our homework, do you want us to graph it? Or just
only if it says graph it. I mean, follow the instructions.
Right.
The instructions that were on the board just say complete the table.
Yeah,
that doesn't mean to graph. So if the instructions said complete the table, if it says complete the table and graph, then do both, right? I'm just taking it to the next, I think, the next level of learning. We're just going to go ahead and graph
it.
It
really bothered me on Friday that the lines like straight with the points.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, but then I like got it that they can be like squiggly.
Oh, they can, yes. That is the point of this one, is to show you again that not all graphs are lines, some are squiggly. Yeah, Avery.
How would you do it since there's like two of the same points?
That's a good question.
The
secret to it, yeah, they're not the exact same point, but the same y value. The secret to it is to understand what a graph is. Okay, have I ever told you what a graph is?
Yes.
Yes. So many times we're sick of being told the same thing. Okay, so if we're sick of it, then we should really internalize it and, you know, really make it part of our brain and our knowledge that we know what the graph is. Let me graph these points real quick. Negative 2, negative 1. Negative 1, positive 3. 0, positive 1. 1, negative 1. And 1, positive 3.
Wait, like, how would you connect
those
lines?
It was 2 plus.
Yeah, okay, I said the wrong thing. Okay, so the graph looks the way it should so far, given the values from this table. So, like, how do we connect them? Again, we want to stop thinking of graphs as points and then connecting points. The thing that connects the points, you know what that thing is? A bunch of points. Okay? It's just a bunch of points. We didn't take the time to find the way we did for these. Yes, it would take us forever, literally forever, because there are an infinite number of points that we could find. Okay, so when we draw that connected thing, what we're doing is just filling in the gaps best we can to save ourselves some time. We're kind of cheating a little bit by drawing all those points. Okay, as I look around the room, I see some people making some choices, some bad choices. They're mostly affecting themselves. I'm going to continue to let them make those choices, but I know not going to be very helpful for them to continue to act the way they're acting. Kaden?
Why aren't they in a straight line? You would easily have them in a straight line.
Because
they're not.
Not all graphs need to be lines. And actually, like, if you look at all the graphs there could be, very few of them are straight lines. Like, only a special subset of graphs are just good, tried and true, dependable, straight lines. Most of them, if we just looked at all the graphs, most of them have some kind of curve to them. Again, Avery's been raising his hand for a while.
So like when you like connect the lines, do you just do it in like order of the way you pointed them or put the points down?
Well, not necessarily, because, you know, what if I did them all scattered? I don't want to connect it. Like, that can't be the rule, right? Because if we all do it in different orders, I guess let's back up a little bit. We should all wind up with the same graph, because there's one graph that belongs to this equation, not lots of different graphs. Right? And so the rule was just go in the order that you put them down. If we all put them down in different orders, then we all have different graphs. Right?
Yes.
Okay. So the rule is a graph is made of a bunch of points. Okay? They try to be good guessers. That's kind of the answer.
Could you cheat with a graph, you know?
That was
just like draw like lines and lines.
How would that be cheating?
I don't know. Because you draw the dots and the lines. So if you draw whole lines on all the boxes, maybe.
Well, this graph is not going to be a bunch of like these lines and these lines. It's going to be a very specific, in this case, a curve, not a line. Right? It's going to be a curve. It's going to be curvy. The other thing is, it's not going to be just a bunch of straight lines connected together. Right? Because you got to keep in mind that this graph reflects like what we would get if we had a much more detailed table. We had a much more detailed table, by that meaning that we have like all the decimals between -2 and -1, which we couldn't possibly have on this table because there's an infinite number of decimals between -2 and -1. But if it were possible somehow, right? And we found all the y values. The transitions of those points would be gradual. It wouldn't be abrupt. Okay? It wouldn't be abrupt like straight lines meeting each other at points. Right? So what we're going to do is try and make a guess of where all these points wind up. And here's some things that I know. Like, well, between -2 and -1, I know that for -2, I get a y value of -1. For an x value of -1, I get a y value of 3. So what I'll bet is that if I plugged in a number between -2 and -1 for x, or let's look at it on the table, if I were to plug a number between -2 and -1 on this table, I bet you the y values I got would gradually increase from -1 up to 3. You see what I'm saying there? They gradually increase the values that I plug in for x from -2 to -1, the y values would increase steadily from -1 to +3. And I'm going to show that on the graph. I bet if I put in something close to -2, I would get some point that's close to, some y values close to -1. And I bet it would slowly transition up close to that point. Okay? And when I draw this shape, I'm really guessing at all of those points that would land wherever they land. Is my guess going to be absolutely 100% correct? No, it's not. That's the thing about drawing a graph. Our graphs might be slightly different, but they should have a lot of the same characteristics, right? It should climb from here to there, right? And if I continue to draw points, I bet they would come down through. Well, you've got to go through that point, and that point, and that point. Now what happens to the right and the left?
They just go on forever.
They do whatever they want.
Whoa.
Something happens, and you know, we can talk about it and figure out what it would do, but we haven't really investigated. So the best we do is a guess.
Yep.
Maybe it's gonna be very curvy continually. Maybe it'll shoot out in one direction. Maybe it'll flatten out. I mean, we don't know because we haven't done anything with
maybe
it.
It'll maybe it'll make their hair spots.
Maybe what? Avery?
Could it like go the other way too? Like are all the graphs gonna be
back this way?
Yeah.
Yeah.
No. Okay, so here's one thing that I won't explain fully right now. But like a graph is not going to double back on itself, right? You shouldn't be able to draw a vertical line and intersect the graph twice. Or three times or four times. Only once. Okay? At least if we're talking about a function. I'm underlining this word function here. Okay? All right. We're over time. Thank you very much. Have a good